things? All right. Well, welcome, everybody, to Learn and Master Guitar Live. We are very excited to have our special guest with us, Will McFarlane. Will, thank you so much for being here with us. I'm so glad you're here. We're going to be talking about blues guitar for this lesson. We've got all kinds of great things coming up. Got some giveaways, other fun stuff. Before we get into all of that, we're just going to play for you a little bit. We're going to do a little bit of a blues in A to get us started off with. So here we go. One, two, one, two, three. I knew this was going to be a good night. Will, it is so great to hear you play. Thank you so much for being a part of this and for driving up and all that stuff.
Oh, it's really a pleasure. I'm enjoying playing. I like getting this little beauty out, you know.
Well, we're going to talk a little bit more about your guitar and the stuff you're running through and all of those things. Before we get too far into it, let me just tell you how this is going to work. We're going to be doing a couple of giveaways like we do. We're going to be giving away two things. One of them is the a great pedal by JHS Pedals, which is a pedal that one of your favorite pedals, from what I understand.
Yeah, I use a bunch of his stuff, actually.
This is an all-American distortion pedal, about $200 worth of one of the most versatile distortion pedals from what I was learning about it.
He loves the rat. But he wanted to tweak it a little in a way, or give you the same basic thing. And of course, I'll explain it later. But it's got three different settings, and you can sort of, you know, the rat. I love rats, but you got to find it in there. This gives you it's a little more forgiving, a little fatter, if you ask me.
We'll be giving that away, as well as also we're kind of making this a blues special. So the blues course that I did, Learn to Master Blues Guitar, we're going to be giving one of those away as well, and that'll be probably around 7:30. And for this lesson, we have been officially told that anybody can get the giveaway. In the past, it's been only limited to U.S. people. Now we've officially been told on this we can do it international. So anyone watching here, you got to be on our Ustream channel though, and that Ustream channel is Gibson's Learn and Master Guitar. And if you're logged in, then one of our guys will pick a couple of names around 7:30, and we'll give these things away, and should be a lot of fun. That's always a lot of fun. Couple of things I need to mention as well. There's also going to be a sale for this live lesson only on the blues guitar course. If you'll notice, underneath the Ustream window, there are three little boxes down there. One of them should be the blues guitar course special sale. So if you don't win the blues guitar course at 7:30, then click down there on that sale. Christmas is coming. We've got that coming on. And this is especially for live lesson, for this live lesson only. So that sale will only be going through this link that is actually in this live lesson. So if you don't have the blues guitar course, tonight might be a great time to get that at a good price. We are going to be talking about blues guitar. In the main Gibson's Learn and Master Guitar course, this is around session 13. So if you're around there, this is about, that's the session that we cover the blues in. Talk about the blues form and all of these different aspects of it. And we are here with a blues legend.
I'm not quite sure about
a legend, definitely. lots of fun things ahead. Let's get right into talking to Will McFarlane. Will has played for, gosh, even just the little that I know. I've seen you with James Taylor, and I've seen you with Kid Rock.
Well, those were interesting gigs. Those were more, I played with Kid Rock when I was inducted in the Musicians Hall of Fame. Honestly, that was, again, the grace of the wonderful Swampers, the rhythm section I played with in Muscle Shoals for 20 years. And they're delightful guys. And they included five of their friends in the induction. And so when we were inducted, we were doing Muscle Shoals, you know, standards like old-time rock and roll. Never Loved a Man, When a Man Loves a Woman, we were playing on those songs, and Kid Rock came out and sang. So we actually really hit it off. It was a great, great night with Kid Rock. I was in Bonnie Raitt's band for 6 years, and that was really where I cut my teeth standing next to you. I mean, the opening acts and the bands we were on the bills with were just, to me, the best in the world. I mean, Muddy Waters and B.B. King and Buddy Guy and Junior Wells and Little Feat and Jackson Brown and Ry Cooder, and, you know,
man,
it was sort of the who's who of the great touch folks of the 60s and 70s. So, you know, you just, a lot of it's osmosis. You stand around and, you know, these guys, when Bonnie would, you know, hit a beautiful lick, you know, you didn't want to just rip into something. You sort of, you know, you just wanted to be sweet. And it was always, I consider myself more of a mutt, you know. We're, you know, blues is the foundation and it's the anchor, that American roots thing. Yeah. But you build the walls of the, you know, the soulful country, and being in Muscle Shoals, I mean, we did, you know, Etta James and Bobby Bland and John Taylor.
When was that time?
I unfortunately didn't get to Muscle Shoals until 1980.
Mm-hmm.
And so they'd been doing, you know, I've had the good fortune of playing with Pops and Mavis Staples and Candy Staten.
Yeah.
And of course Percy Sledge, but we started doing Johnny Taylor, Little Milton, Bobby Bland records.
Yeah.
And so I did those records for decades, you know, a couple of decades. And so same thing, you can tell when you're out of the vibe immediately, and it's more R&B, you know, you'd be into more of a, you know, real laid back. I mean, I'd like to do stuff like that, but you knew the horns were going to come in later. But you know that. Real sweet licks. They call them love licks.
Yeah.
I want some love licks on the And so, you know, you learned how to just answer these delightful guys.
Yeah.
You sit there and you listen and you say, that's mine. I think I'll come in under there.
That's right. Now, how'd you get started playing guitar?
Oh, you know, I just, honestly, I think the thing that I wanted to play guitar before 1964, because believe it or not, we had a Harry Belafonte record that had Jamaica Farewell on it.
Yep.
Little cool little thing on it. And my aunt, we were living with the time, my dad, I'm a Navy brat, so my dad was overseas, and she got me a little acoustic guitar, a little Regal. You know, little.
Did you come from a musical family?
My mother was very musical. My mom died when I was real young, but I know it's genetic. I mean, she went to University of Texas for music, and my dad played trumpet in high school and things like that. And my grandfather actually sang the Texas state song for ratification in the 20s before the joint legislature of Texas. So I've got a lot of Texas history here. As a matter of fact, I had two eight generation uncles leave Muscle Shoals in 1839 to go join the Texas Rangers. So
really?
I have a little Muscle Shoals history in there too. So I did have a musical upbringing, and my stepmother started giving me piano lessons when I was seven. Mm-hmm. But I know it was February 9th, 1964 when I saw the Beatles on Ed Sullivan. I know that was it. There was something in me that, as absurd as it sounds, I went, that's what I do. I just, I knew it's what I was. And I, you know, it was expected I'd go to the Naval Academy, and I was, you know, pretty much on a track.
Yeah.
And music was to be part of a well-rounded education. You don't do it for a living, you know, which might have been a nice thought at the time. But if I'd known it was going to be as crazy, I might have... I couldn't have been anything else. And so I saw the Beatles, and I sat there. And then after that, I really wanted an electric guitar. My piano lessons started lagging, and I just didn't even want to play piano anymore.
What was your first electric?
My first electric, I remember it was called a Regent. It had a pseudo, you know, it was like a one of those cheap mahogany slabs with the the pickup selectors were light switches. You know what I mean? The rocking white plastic.
Yes.
And you could talk into them. They were so microphonic. Yeah. You know, those sort of looked Tiesco-ish or Kentish.
Yeah.
But it was called a Regent.
Yeah.
And so the R went into the sort of the pseudo Fender bulge out there. It was R-E-G-E-N-T. And it was
What are you playing today?
This is a reissue. It's a little classic. It's very light. It's actually, for me, I like to feel a little... I like to feel a little spank.
Yeah.
Not all Les Pauls that I play, you know, they're great and creamy and wide open, but they don't always have that, you know... But this one... It's got a little bit of that.
Yep.
And I'm used to playing, you know, I play a hybrid style with my nails. Mm-hmm. And so I love this guitar. It's a very hot guitar, actually. Mm-hmm. You know, when I take it out on stage, all of a sudden, all stage volumes jump up immediately, but it records beautifully, and it's really been a pleasure to own. And so,
now tell us about what you're running through. I see you're running through a Princeton over there.
Yeah, that Princeton, actually, we've had to tone it down for the internet down here. I've got this little Princeton on two.
what size speaker is it?
It's got a 10-inch speaker in it.
Wow, it gets such a big sound.
It's a huge sound.
Beautiful.
It's just a real, I don't know, I'm in love with it. It was actually rotting in a friend's tool shed for 17 years. And he was showing me around his place, and I looked in the tool shed, and you know, you can see, guitar players can see black Tolex from, you know, hundreds of miles away. And I went, is that an amp? Yeah, a little Fender thing. I said, you use it? You get it working, it's yours.
Yeah.
And I had to put some, you know, we had to restore it back. It's a 69, it's restored to, you know, 64 specs. And I do have a Naylor speaker in it, which has a real magnet on it. And, you know, I mean, a regular magnet's about the size of a 50-cent piece on these things. But it's that gives it the headroom. Yeah. And it's... special little amp.
And then what are you running through down here? Just kind of give us a quick tour of what you got going on.
A quick tour down here is that I'm into a Buddha wah. I didn't know if I'd use a wah-wah pedal tonight
or
not.
Can you show us a little bit about what that's doing for
this
you?
This thing, there's a... It's just a really deliberate little wah-wah pedal. It's very warm. I like it. They swore, you know, there's a lot of R&D going on at Buddha.
Yeah.
And they... they swear they nail Hendrix's specs. And so. You can hear how nice easy and smooth.
Very smooth.
And so I like this pedal. It's a great pedal. I do have a 69 Thomas Organ Crybaby at home that I think actually beats it out in a real, if you really get seriously into it. I go out of that into a tuner here. It's a Planet Waves tuner. And then I have a Mirage compressor that I use very little of. It's like an LA-2A. It's very warm. Mm-hmm. It just, you know. Yeah, I figured at this low volume, I'd put just a touch in there to hold line level and I wouldn't spike these guys over there. And then I actually, in this pedal right here, I have a Morning Glory, which is another JHS pedal,
right,
which is their, you know, that
What is the Morning Glory? That's an overdrive?
Yeah. You can hear it just puts a little on. You know, it's got that real...
It's a real warm sound. I like
and
that.
It's very transparent. It doesn't change my, you know, I like transparent. If I get something that I like this guitar, I like that amp. I like how it sounds with nothing in line. So if I hit something, you know, if I'm soloing and I want a little more, you know, you don't hear, you know.
No, yeah.
It doesn't color it. It doesn't throw that typical mid-range hump over things, and I think he's doing a great job. I really do. It's one of the reasons I recommended the JHS guy.
This is if we have that link, Tom, maybe you can put up that link for us, or one of the guys. Maybe y'all have already done it. It's JHSpedals.com. They have all kinds of different pedals. As I was looking there, they had the Morning Glory Overdrive, several others, and then I see the next one in your chain is the All American.
The All-American is, I use it mostly for sliding wide open stuff. It's my, the newest one. The actual one I use most of the time is his mod, his Tube Screamer mod, where he pulls the mids out of it a little and gives it a little more gain. It can be more of a, you can almost use it like a clean boost, and you can't do that with a normal Tube Screamer to me. To me, Tube Screamers are great for single coils that might be a little wiry and you're in a blues environment and you want to, you know, fatten it up. You know. But I don't, generally my stuff's fat enough without it, and I don't, you know. But this, the Morning Glory, again, I have dialed down a lot for right now, but again, you don't hear it change the tone, you know. You know. I have it a lot hairier here. It's great for stuff like... Great for that kind of stuff, and I actually it has a toggle switch on it, and I've got it set for the most overdrive.
Yeah.
As opposed to it gets more saturated, it goes from overdrive to distortion really, down to where you can click it in the middle, and it's sort of a combination of overdrive and you get a little bit hairier, and then you click it all the way down, it's almost like solid state. You know, it almost just turns into a rat really.
Yeah.
And so it's a very versatile pedal. It's great for slide.
Can you? I see you have a slide there. Can you play a little slide for us?
A little bit. You know, if I were to get a tone, you know. You know, it's hairy. I mean, it's hairy right now. And if you really want, you know, you can dial it back a little bit. But I already have this one sort of set on just a little crunch. Yeah. So that one's on stun, you know.
And then I see you're running through a regular.
I just brought this, when I'm in the studio, this is a simple live rig for me when I don't have to be under the microscope as much. In the studio, I actually have a tap thing, you know, so I don't really... you know, mess with things. But I love this. There's some of it. You just hear a little bit of, you know. You know, it's just
beautiful.
Very, very warm.
We're going to try and take a picture of his pedal board before Will leaves, and we'll put that up on our discussion board as well. But what we're talking about there is just a little bit of a delay. It's an MXR.
The carbon copy. Well, I bought it with my Christmas money one year, you know what I mean? So it came with the generous people who just sent money in my Christmas cards. I went out and saw this. And honestly, it's that old, what they call bucket technology. Yeah. It's not hi-fi. It gets warmer. It's more like the tape delays. It gets lower, you know, it goes ding, 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 you know. It's like if you put a lot of repeats on it, the third or fourth one down the line is just totally broken up, and I like that. It's warmer to me.
Now you have done so much rhythm guitar playing; it's just brilliant. Brilliant. Will was at our guitar gathering this year, and I remember coming away from that thinking, gosh, every time this man touched his guitar, it sounded like a record. It just sounded like a classic lick that is something that you've heard on some great recording.
I'm glad you think so.
It's true. Talk to us a little bit about rhythm guitar playing, what you've learned along the way, about what to add into a song, what a song needs and what it doesn't need. And
I like to start with a story. I don't always start with it, but it's been on my mind lately because I just told it to somebody the other day. And, you know, I was in the Muscle Shoals rhythm section really played with them for 20 years and moved down there from L.A. after I got out of Bonnie's band. I was looking for a place to raise my kids, you know, and L.A. wasn't that for me. And got down there, and everybody had been cutting records for years, and the great records. I'll Take You There in Kodachrome and Old Time Rock and all these things. And so sitting with them, you don't get hired for what you know, actually, in a lot of ways. You get hired for what you know how to leave out. You know, you get hired for what you don't play in a lot of ways. You know, I think it takes you so many years to learn how to do some things that are sort of vaguely interesting, and then it takes you the next 10 years to figure out what of that to leave out. And so I was that guy. I was, you know, I come from that rhythm guitar school, the Cornell Dupree, Steve Cropper. I'm a huge Reggie Young fan. I'm just he's a wonderful musician. And I come from that school. And so when I moved down there, I just wanted to sit in. And I always say that one day I was actually playing acoustic guitar, a very simple part, and every several bars, you know, Roger just a little lift or something. And I just sort of, with the acoustic, did a little, came out of, you know, up, down rhythm and just did the lift with him, you know. And somehow that day it was just glistening on tape, you know. And Roger just turned to me, and he's not, you know, quick with compliments. He's just regular guy, but he turned to me and he went, playing good today. I said, well, I'm just listening to you. And he said, good players are good listeners. And I think that's it. When you go into a rhythm guitar environment, when you want to be part of the band, you've got to have enough under the hood to be spontaneous. Because if you go in there just thinking about what you're going to do to try to get your ideas on, you're not going to have a conversation. It would be as if I wasn't listening to the questions you were asking me. And I was answering completely other questions because I wanted to say something else. And that's the same way that the musical communication is. And to be a session guy, I really think you sit down and we might listen to a demo and look at a chart, and then we drop into something, and you can already tell where people are sort of landing. And there's always a place for you to enter into the conversation. And if there isn't, lay out. You know, a lot of times I can tell you, I can't tell you how many times I didn't come until the second verse, or I didn't come until the chorus, or you know what I mean? Because it just seemed right. Without me, and sometimes it's best to listen. And right now I say, oh, I have something to add to that conversation. And to have enough in you. And basically, you know, I could teach you a lick, as I say, and you'd know a lick. But if you understand the way I think, I really believe there are three basic sort of pattern groups on the guitar. You know, there's an E, you know.
Talk to us about that.
You know, there's an E, basically, and you can go F, F sharp, G, whatever. There's an A, flat B, C, you know, and there's a C, and a lot of young players don't think about this one. You know, there's the C sharp, and there's a D, really, and the reason we do it like that is because we have the open D string, but if you think about it like this, it's more it's more expansive. You know, if you think of it more like that, you're going to swing differently, you're going to have more options where you are. And so, if I know that that's an A, that's an A, that's an A, or whatever, that's an E, you know. You know, if I know where they are, you break them up into little groups, as you asked for two stops. You'd mentioned that to me earlier, and I mean, if I had a nickel back for every time I've done a two-stop or tipped my hat to a Cornell Dupree or somebody like that on tape, I'd be independently wealthy, you know. I mean, because, you know, here's my A chord, you know, or I can skip one and be in sixths, you know, or skip that one and be in, but, you know, if I know that's an A and I go, or whatever, I switch from fourths to thirds, whatever, here's, you know, I'm in this A position right here, that from A, you can switch to the sixth, but so, the great rhythm guitar parts that you think about, like a Drift Away, you know, the then you hit.
Yep. No.
You know, that kind of. He never hit more than two notes at a time.
As you're doing it, let's just take that little lick that you were doing there, that little double stop lick. I don't know what key you're in.
I was in B, so I went to the fourth. Yeah, right on.
Okay, so you're basically doing this in, what is that? That's a fourth there. You have a B and an F sharp. Yeah. And then you're sliding up a whole step. And then you can also do it down here on the F sharp and the C sharp. You can move around between those two.
That's right.
You can slide those around.
Exactly.
Turn that into a third, maybe. You can do the same thing here. You can turn this into a third. And just keep working on.
You know, they sound, sometimes when you, if you do the fourths, it's more R&B. Like if I'm in a, go down to the key of A maybe, and if I'm in a, you know, if I go, it almost takes a little more country,
a little
at that
country
point,
feel, yeah.
But that's okay. Hendrix did that, you know, like a lot of "When Cries Mary" and stuff was, you know, yeah. Which is very two step. But it's he's not going, you know, he's not doing fourths. He's doing thirds, and it's good to know them both because. You know, even guys like, you know, Robin Ford will even do sevenths like that. He'll be.
Now that's the, the fifth and the flatted seventh?
Yeah, I'm doing
there?
A fifth and a flat seven in the key of A. It's really, it's a C.
Right.
You know, what most people, and most people do slide it, but Robin.
Hammered up to
on a, one of his tunes. Hammered it. I remember hearing that. It just sounded fresh to me because, in a way, I don't use that as much in a blues environment. But he's sort of blending the different roots of the sort of country blues, and once you know that A, that, and you go, went way country on that. That's another thing. You can land on them straight. You can land on the D straight here, that, or you could go. And it's good to train yourself to bend notes in tune.
Yeah.
You know, because a lot of guys, they learn a steel lick, you know, but they don't make it sound, you know.
Yeah,
I do it on a telly most of the time. Excuse me, but it sounds great on this guitar. And learning how to bend in tune, and I just went to a D chord. Again, if you know that's your D right there, you can get to that.
So I don't know if y'all can see this. I wish we had a better camera angle. He's at the 12th, up here at the 12th fret on the kind of an A, a fifth string A, fourth string D. Third string F sharp there.
But I'm starting on an E. I'm putting my finger on an E.
And then you're bending down. I don't even know if I can do that. Oh, that's cool.
Matter of fact, you can even lay a finger down if you want to go. You know, you can add.
Oh, that takes a little bit of control.
Yeah,
but
you
yes.
Do.
What was that?
I was just substituting an open string for a scale.
Mm-hmm.
Any scale on the neck. I started on the four of a D scale, which would go whatever.
Right.
But if you go, see what I'm doing?
Yep.
I'm just substituting an open string for, instead of picking the next string in order. I'm just looking around. There are all sorts of things like that. Like if that was in D. You can use that Mixolydian for A. You can go, you know, which is a D scale.
Do that slow.
scale against an A, and the only difference is one of them has a C. You know,
yeah, it has
major,
a C
one of them has a C sharp, so yeah. It makes it an A mixolydian. Yep. You know, and or a G scale.
I hope y'all are kind of understanding the concept there.
The concept is just throwing in an open string, finding out where an open note would be in the scale, and picking that instead of the next fingered note.
And there's all kinds of... I know I do a couple of arpeggios like that. Kind of more on fingerstyle I do it here, but...
That's beautiful.
Kind of a... This is a C, C pentatonic sort of a thing. C here at the eighth fret. Then I hit the open D, E at the 7th fret, open G, let's see, I can't do it slow.
I know.
A and the open B, and then here I go C, D, C, D, open E, and then I bring it back down.
And you see, actually, that's a really nice thing, too. You can do that against an E minor, because the difference in an C sharp major 7. And you can go, you know, you can do that against an E minor or the C, or you could just, in a blues environment, there are times where I was playing actually in the key of like an A minor blues or even a G major blues, you know, you can go, you know what I mean? That.
Yeah.
Which is sort of what you were doing.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was again. So just finding an open string. Again, a lot of times this comes out of the fact that when I'm the rhythm guy. I was actually the rhythm guy in bands for 7 years before I ever took a solo when I was a young guy. We always had a lead guitar player, and I was happy not to be a lead player. So so a lot of, as I say, I would hold things, and my right hand would be going, you know. Never sort of let up, you know.
No.
And I got a lot of that from watching Cornell Dupree in 1975. I moved into New York City so that I could see. It was pre-stuff, you know. McKell's, it's Cornell Dupree and Gordon Edwards and Steve Gadd on drums and Richard T.
Yeah.
And Sanborn started sitting in. It was just amazing musical environment. And I just sat me to you to Cornell a couple of nights a week many times. And he would just sit there so lazily and just do this rhythm stuff. And even when he soloed, it still seemed like he didn't change dispositions. His hand was still so in that pocket.
Yeah.
Very simple stuff, you know, like, and he'd mix a little BB. He might go. You know, just that kind of, I didn't let up, you know, I sort of, this hand's just, I'm landing where I sort of feel, and a plus, you know, there are other guys in the band, and they're going, and Richard T was, I mean, he's, who was like him, so, you know, Cornell knew his place, he didn't occupy a lot of space, but every time he spoke, you listened. You know?
Yeah, so many people think that guitar playing is just all about solos. Man, if I could only be the best soloist, I just want to be this incredible soloist. And you just don't realize until you think about it that, or actually get into the job of creating music, that there's so many more parts that are being laid down in layers on a song that are just little rhythm guitar parts, groove here, just a little bit of a lick there that has nothing to do with solos. You know, you could never play a solo and still be an incredible guitarist if you can just be a master at doing the background, the little rhythm stuff.
Well, you think back about the early Impressions records with Curtis Mayfield on rhythm guitar and how beautiful and just signatory those rhythm guitar parts are. Bobby Womack, or as I said, Cornell Dupree, a lot of people don't realize he's the opening to, you know, whatever. You know, Rainy Night in Georgia.
Yeah.
And so many things, so many Aretha tunes. And you don't realize these guys in the background. And I was talking to Jerry Wexler the one time I fortunately got to work for him on this Etta James record, and Steve Cropper was on it, and I was on it, and Lucky Peterson. It was a wonderful record with Willie Weeks on bass. And I cut a couple of tracks with Steve Winwood with the rhythm section with David Hood and Roger Hawkins. And just musical and wonderful. And I asked Jerry Wexler about Cornell Dupree. He said, "Oh, Will, before Cornell," he said, "I always had three guitar players on those old, you know, Solomonberg records and all these old soul records. He'd have one guy doing the chords, one guy maybe doing, you know, some chunks. Kind of chunks, and then another guy maybe doing octaves or something else." He said, "The first session I ever used Cornell on, I fired the other two guys, just used one guy, because Cornell just made the track feel so great by himself." And it was, like you're saying, that, you know, that rhythm lead. Like there was a lead guitar player on that, there was one rhythm guitar, and there was one guy
keeping the chunk,
you know, keeping the chunk going. And it was just sort of, I just got that easy thing going, you know. And if I got, I don't think I could have made a living if I were just a soloist. You know, you figure the average record, if it had back in the day, had 10 tunes on it, and there might be at the most two major guitar solos, even in the 70s, you know what I mean, or three maybe. But there's 10 tunes. Yeah. They might have a sax solo coming in one. They might have no solo, or piano, or an organ, or and all this stuff. So you, if they brought in a killer guy just to really be the specialist solo to do the guy, solo, he's going to come in, be there for an hour and do two solos, maybe one. But I was there for 2 days cutting tracks, you know what I mean? And hanging with the guys and being in the band. And to me, being the rhythm guitar player was just, it was the life I felt I was, you know? Yeah. Just think it's a very valuable thing to know. Plus, as I say, a lot of the, for example, I've worked with a lot of guys who came up in the 80s and they became blisteringly fast sort of modal theorists, you know, and they just, they could do amazing stuff, but they couldn't have this jam with us today, you know, because they never really actually learned chords. They never broke it up. They just went, oh, I'm an A, is it minor, major, do I do Dorian, do I do Aeolian? They knew certain theories, but they didn't know how to build chords. You know, they just didn't. And I really think it's more interesting because once you see a chord, then you know I have this permission, you know. And it
right.
And I stop playing in boxes. I stop going, okay, Phrygian mode. I start going, I'm at the one. Now I'm at the four. You know, I'm. So I'm more playing the changes than I am saying, okay, I could have stayed basically in a blues scale for all of that. But it's just more interesting to have the option to play the changes.
Amazing. Rhythm guitar, again, for me is much more interesting as well. It's much more of a mental game. How can I fit into the groove of what's going on? How can I create something that is the bass, the drums, and me, and we could all create this wave that everything else is riding on.
Sometimes you're doing a traditional track and you can tell I just need to drop into a or something. You know, sometimes that's perfect. Sometimes that's perfect, but sometimes you go in and you're working for, let's say, a European, but back in the 90s sometimes these guys would come over and they come to Muscle Shoals because they wanted the feel, but they wanted something to grab them, so they didn't want, that was just too traditional. You know, what can we do? You know, and they might want... They might want you to sting it a little more, or they might want just something so odd just to go. and just do little, and you find your hole and you go, see, there's nothing there, put something there. And they would point and you just go, you know, it's a little counterintuitive to the way I've been playing here, but, you know, to be flexible enough to throw a bunch of ideas at somebody and say, well, do you want it high? Do you want it low? Do you want it to sort of go, I mean, I've done parts like that on records, you know, where you go, and put even a little, you know, and I'm thinking, well, that's dirty to me, but they go, put some distortion on it. And really, I did. I did a record for a French artist. It became a Grammy winner in France.
Really?
For a guy named Eddie Mitchell. His French name is something else, but that's his stage name. And we'd have it sound like Muscle Shoals. It was Reggie Young and me on guitar, and Roger and David and Clayton Ivey. So it was, you know, we'd be sitting there, and we'd get it feeling just like I liked it. You know, I mean, we'd all be looking at each other, and that feels great. And the producer would go, no, it's... distortion on that. I say, you want the same part with distortion? I might be going, and all of a sudden now I'm going, you know, or whatever, you know. And I'm thinking, boy, that's hurting me, you know. But when you hear the final mix, they had something in
mind.
They
had a vision, yeah.
And it became very interesting to me because they really got me out of my comfort zone, and they wanted me to do Muscle Shoals licks with lots of hair on the guitar and things like that. Yeah. So you just to be flexible enough to do stuff you wouldn't normally do, you know, to break you out of your default modes. And all of us have them.
That's right. Well, it is about that time, kids. Let's give away something. We're going to give away the JHS pedal, this All-American distortion. Talk about it. When did you get familiar with JHS? Pedals.
You know, unbelievably, he got in touch with me that we had a mutual friend, and he had heard some of my plan.
Was it? Did you talk to John, or was it?
Josh called me.
Josh.
Yeah, Josh called me. He actually Facebooked me. It's amazing how much work comes through. How many delightful things come through Facebook. He Facebooked me, and I gave him my phone number, and he called me one day, and he said, "I just love your plan. I'd like you to use some of my stuff." And he already had, you know, big bands using his stuff. You know, he had a bunch of big endorsements out there. And I said, well, you know, when I was sort of locked out, I had a Klon on the floor.
Yeah.
And, you know, some classic things. I had a, you know, modded Tube Screamer. And it's still, both of them still have marvelous usages. But he said, well, let me just send you something to see if you like it. And he started with the Morning Glory. No, he modded a Tube Screamer. And then he sent me a Morning Glory, and then I met up with him at the Amp Expo here in Nashville.
Nashville Amp
which
Expo.
Which was great, really well done. And his room was rocking. I mean, JHS's room was rocking, man. It was some of the best sound there and all this, and I was up there. And at one point, he was putting me through some different things, and this just jumped out that day. And I said, man, you know, I don't have anything that saturates quite that much. And he said, here, just take this with you and see if you like it.
Wow.
And he goes, because I love this. And he says it'll give you more tweak than a rat, and it'll give you some real versatility. And it does. It's just, I think it's a great pedal. And he calls it the All-American.
The All-American distortion.
Because, I mean, it'll give you that old, you know, that old rock and roll. And, you know, I mean, it would sound a lot different if I were just a little more gain on, you know, I'm down to two on that amp, but it really responds well to a little more gain. You know.
This wonderful custom pedal is about $200 worth of distortion pedal. Very functional, very many different sounds you can get on this. And the winner, are you guys ready? The winner of the JHS pedal is Sean 53. So, Sean 53, you have just won yourself one heck of a distortion pedal. If you can, Sean, one of our guys will be private messaging you. If you can just make sure don't leave before we have your information and your email address and address.
That's great. You'll enjoy it.
So, a lot of fun with that. We're also going to be giving away a blues guitar course that I did to someone. And we could autograph that. I bet if we bribed Will, we could get him to autograph it, too. So we're going to the winner of the blues course is Hopp3, H-O-P-P-3. Hopp3, you just won yourself a blues guitar course. And so I hope you enjoy that. I love the giveaway stuff. I wish we could give away more stuff. Anyway, so that's a lot of fun. Make sure, Hop, that we get all of your information so we can actually send it to you and all that sort of stuff. Great. We did have some questions. Well, before we even get to that, can you play us something? Do you have a song or something you can play for us?
Sure.
On the spot?
Yeah.
With no rehearsal? Just cold.
Yeah,
or we
I'll,
can...
I'll do a little something. How about something I wrote lately with my kids? My sons are both musicians. I've got a bass-playing son, and he's been up to New York and studied with John Patitucci and Lincoln Goins, and so he's actually a bass player, too. He feels like Muscle Shoals, but he's got a little under the hood, too.
Yeah.
And my youngest son's a guitarist, and we got started getting together, trying to get together and write something. So this is something we wrote together. I might as well throw it out there and see what you think. It's sort of a... We were thinking of the old Delbert...
Yeah.
Bandish kind of thing, and came out sounding hopefully like something that's been around a while. It goes, "You woke me last night, you were talking in your sleep. It sounded like you're wondering if a love's gonna keep. Baby, can't you see? Ain't nobody loved you like me. Now I can assure you there's no reason to doubt. I'm the last one on earth you got to worry about. Baby, can't you see? Ain't nobody loves you like me. You think there's a problem, you wanna be sure? Well, I can set your mind at ease. 'Cause if you went out looking to see if there's more, you'd come back begging, baby, please. 'Cause you can look to the left, baby, look to the right. Look all day long and even into the night. And you're gonna see, ain't nobody loves you like me."
Your name?
Yeah.
Wonderful. And we even got that ending that we never worked on before, just like we rehearsed it.
Just like we rehearsed it. That's
great. Wow. Thank you so much, Will. We've got several questions that are going on. We've got some that have come on the discussion board. So we're going to talk about those, see if we can answer a couple of those first. And then I want to take some questions from the those of you who are watching us live. So the guys are going to help us put some of your questions up here so I can see them. But let's get started out. Kurt from Minnesota writes on the discussion board, "When I pick notes with my thumb, then I feel that I have a little bit more control over the tone and the feeling of the note versus using a pick. Is this common, and does Will or anyone he knows use this technique while playing really emotional blues tunes, maybe a B.B. King, Thrill Is Gone, or something like that?"
Well, if you ever look, a lot of the guys, the Thrill Is Gone, you know, that... I actually practice with my fingers a lot, but not just solely my thumb. But there is something that I, every now and then, like, you know, that I like the meat of my hand.
Yeah.
But I'm just, I use my thumb when I do octaves.
Yeah.
But I just realized somewhere along the way, you know, guys like Freddie King uses them. I mean, just hit it hard, and it just absolutely felt like he was tearing the strings off. He's just an unbelievable player. I'm a huge fan of his. But I just realized that wasn't me. I'm a more subtle touch, and I feel like I've gotten to the place between my fingers and my, you know, I went back and forth between my fingers and thumb. And I don't think you can really tell the difference. I've gotten sort of, you know, I like the mixture of that, but if I go, you know, and the meat of the finger is warmer too, and there are times I slow down enough. I think if you watch a lot of guys, they tuck their pick and they'll use a combination, but I don't know too many guys who only use their thumb. Most of the guys, it's a combination of their fingers.
Now, I notice you've got nails on.
Yeah, I do. I have.
Are those fake? Are those real?
They're my nails, but I had them acrylic. You know,
tell us about that. What,
you know, I go to Nubs to Nails in Florence, Alabama, and for years I was up there with Tracy at Do or Die in North Carolina. Anyway, they dip a paintbrush in a liquid and then into a white powder, and they put it on and it hardens. It's an acrylic, so that I don't snap it, you know.
So it just strengthens your nails.
It strengthens my nails, so, you know. I do play back and forth with my fingers a lot. I just, you know, I just, when I'm on stage, there's so much rhythm stuff I do. My style of music is such that, I don't know, I just have to spank it with a pick.
Yeah, you
know?
Yeah.
But I get that.
Excuse me. Stealth from Sheffield, UK. You had asked about some of the double stop technique, which we've already talked a little bit about that. You go on to say, you gave a video, which unfortunately we can't reference here, but you talk about stabs on 2 and 4 with the guitar, which, for those of you who may not know what is going on, I mean, can you illustrate
that? Well, yeah, I was just going to say, you know, if we have a song that's in 1 and 3, and I were just going to go, the song goes like this. Now, if I started clapping along like this, it's a groove killer to me, but if I go like this, now I'm moving, and the 2 and the 3, the, see what, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and you could just tell, as opposed to 2, 3, 4. Not that that might not be okay at any given time. I'm not trying to say there's only one way to do things. But having lived in Muscle Shoals, Alabama, you know, for most of my life.
You do a lot of guitar playing.
I live by the 2 and the 4. I mean, that's just where the groove is to me. You know?
And you're playing, a lot of times when you're doing those stabs, you're playing just little parts of the chords, maybe a little triad kind of up on the neck or something like that.
Depends on whether you want to commit, like, whether you want to commit to the third or not.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of soul music, or the element of a blues note is that it's not a minor third and it's not a major third. It's
somewhere in between.
It's somewhere in between. So a lot of times you don't want to go, because that made it minor, but it's too happy.
Yeah.
Or even, you know.
Yep.
But now in reggae, where you go, you know, that having the dominant third in those chords is great. You hear that in a lot of, so, but most of the time you go for roots and fifths in that. Or, but if it's a soul tune and you go,
mm-hmm.
kind of thing, whereas I'm just mixing it up, stabbing it on a 7, end up there, and then throw a 9, you know, just color combinations depending on the tune. But again, knowing where they all are and knowing what your options are, you know, knowing that A, that A, that A, that A, and then knowing the A9 down here, you know, and the A9 here, raise 9, that 9 or whatever, 7s, that 9, knowing where they are really helps.
Wonderful. Bill Appledaddy from Newport Beach, California, says, play some more Rainy Night in Georgia music. Is he bending with 1, 2, or 3 fingers? I guess talk about bending technique.
Well, bending, I spent a lot of my life bending notes, you know, because first of all, you know, blues is, you know, when you hear BB go, and then you go, and keeping it in tune, you know, yeah. That was pretty in tune, whatever. Especially for steel stuff where you go. You know, I mean, that's pretty in tune. And learning to bend is great. Now, I just started here with an A7. I bent to that, then I bent to just to the 3rd 5. Then I bent from the 7 flat up, holding the 3rd on top. Then I just bent, you know, which is just creating this chord. Pedal steel lick or bending lick 101 is you're gonna make an A chord, you hold the top 2 down, and you bend. And there's your A chord. Yep. And then here's your D and your E. And pretty soon you might go like, you know, which I just bent an E and to do an E9. That's an E9 chord. I just held a low instead of bending. I held the low one, you know, and those. I'm just forming chords by starting below the chord and bending a note to it. Now, double note, the Rainy Night in Georgia thing is straight, no bends at all. It's.
Check on his wife, I think, is trying to get in.
You know what I mean? It's just no, like. And I know that that's an A.
Right.
That's an A9, you know. So that's the A, the 3rd. So if I go. That makes an A9. It's A6, 9. A lot of times guys will say, oh, it's a 12-8 shuffle. I just want 6s and 9s. Mm-hmm. And you know, I know, you know, I'm going to go 6s and 9s, which is in. A lot of times they refer to it as because that's the 6th chord, that's the 9th chord in A. Mm-hmm. A lot of times, though, they refer to it as 6s and 9s because when you skip a string on a guitar, you go a 6th interval, like all that soul man stuff, you know? Yeah. They don't all make 6th chords, but they're all 6th intervals.
Yeah, the intervals of a 6th.
And so when you skip those top 2, or even here, because you're going, you know, anyway, it's a 6. And break up chords and just bend to them. You can go. Now, I am bending 2 there. Bending 3 is a heck of a lot of fun. Actually, if you go like the old C6 neck kind of stuff, like that. You know, whatever. Yeah. I'm just sort of flying around, but that kind of, and learning to bend all 3 strings in tune, it comes you have to do it for a while. Yeah, you know, yeah. It's easier up high. There's an E sig. Sounds good to just do that, but if you go, there's sort of, it fakes it a little better. You get that Roy Buchanan sort of.
We had a question come in. Who is your favorite guitarist of all time? I know this would.
Oh, I can't. Yeah. I don't know. You know, it's like you love Clapton's vibrato. I mean, I just love that first. You know, that kind of that. That's so. I love that. But I've worked with Reggie Young.
Yeah.
And I've just seen him just become the tune, you know, sit yeah. there and listen and his hands land, you know. You know, that kind of double, that all that, yeah. you know. If all you did was play Drift Away off the top of your head, you know, but I mean, he's the guitar player on so much stuff. You can imagine, probably 5,000 chart singles, I can't imagine.
Another one of the questions that has come in is that when you were really honing your craft, when you really learned how to play, tell us about how you practiced, how much did you practice, what did you practice, what was a...
I really wish I had practiced a lot more. I'm really very much a slow hand, but I still loved the song. I mean, I don't...
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I like a great song, and the guitar is so much more interesting when it's on a great song as opposed to, let's say, just a disco hit or something mm-hmm. like that. You know, I mean, mm-hmm. some of the greatest guitar players in the world made a living playing disco in the back of the day because that's who was hiring and that's what they did. But, mm-hmm. you know, they did, you know, they did tic tacs, yeah. you know. But I like a great song. So I grew up listening to really, honestly, the guys who had great songs. That's all I can say. You know, the yeah. band and
yeah.
and the guys who played. And, well, I love Little Feat. Mm-hmm. I just loved, you know, this yeah. easy, you know, Lowell wasn't, you know, a wide open slide player. Just that kind of, and I don't have my guitar retuned or set up, but just that. Articulate slide yeah, stuff in yeah. Mike Cooter, you know. I love that kind of playing, you know, yeah. real articulate. And so by the time I was 22, I'd started with Bonnie, and I was seeing Little Feat play live, and I was listening to them. And so those are major influences, yeah. you know, the guys who held long notes. At one point, I saw a band called Full Moon that had Buzzy Featon in it, mm-hmm. you know, and Buzzy just was one of the guys who stung like Albert King. But he wasn't, you know, he didn't just live there. It was like, you know, I'm just not even thinking like it, you know. You know, he played like a blues guy, like Robin Ford plays yeah, like a blues yeah. guy. It's not like he was a jazz guy and learned blues. He plays like a blues guy who then got technique out there.
Yeah. Yeah,
and I love those guys. You know, yeah. I love that kind of guy. I'll never be that kind of a. I don't think I don't aspire to be a guitar god. If you really want to know, I really like being in the band.
Yeah,
and so I just sort of spaced out on that last little segment there, but
not at all. As we're closing up here, I was just told that as far as the blues guitar course, the winner of that Hop 3. Has not responded to us yet, so we are going to choose a new guitar course winner, blues guitar course winner, and that's going to be Alla DeFar. Alla DeFar, you've just won yourself a blues guitar course. If Hop 3 responds, we'll give him one too. But as we're closing up, let's I've got a couple of last minute announcements that I want to make sure. And Will's actually going to be traveling on the road up to Knoxville tonight.
Yeah,
so he's got a couple hours of traveling. Tonight, and you're doing a recording session up there, or
up in North Carolina. The next, you know, going to be up in North Carolina for the weekend.
Yeah.
A couple of live shows.
So we've got a couple of announcements before we close things out. We'll play one more thing before we go. The course, the Learn to Master Guitar Song Hits, course is finally in. Those of you who have been keeping up with us on the discussion board know that. And that came in last week, and after I got back from my trip to Cuba. And so that was in, and I frantically signed about 1,900 copies of those. And we got... It was ridiculous. It was a ridiculous couple of days. But we had probably the largest shipping day we've ever had here at Legacy. And seven pallets of courses went out the door on Friday. So if you, some people have already gotten those. Others are on their way. So excited about that. It's a great course. It's you know, that's how I learned to play guitar, was learning guitar skills through applying them in real music, songs that you're familiar with, and that's what we wanted to do with the Song Hits course. So I'm anxious to see how y'all like that. Remember, we've got the blues guitar course on sale. That link is underneath your Ustream window. So that will be on sale for the next little bit, if you, and it's just for our live lesson people. So it'll be up for the next little bit, I've been told. So I'm not sure how many days that is, but I wouldn't linger too long if you're interested in getting the blues course at a great sale. Also, we have skills, Gibson Skills House. On Gibson.com, we have been providing them a lot of educational content, and there's a whole new area on Gibson that is called Gibson Skills House. So if you go to Gibson.com, click the tab on Lessons, go down a couple of notches, you'll see Gibson Skills House. There you're going to find all kinds of lessons. I've got style lessons on there and foundation lessons on there. We also have song lessons where many different instructors are teaching all kinds of different songs. So there's Guitar Apprentice stuff too, which is kind of a guitar learning game. Anyway, all that stuff is at Gibson Skills House. If you haven't checked that out, go ahead and check that out. We put a lot of good stuff over there. And all of this is... based off of learning guitar. That's the whole point, is learning how to play. And we did have a course, I did a course called Gibson's Learn to Master Guitar, of which all of this is from, and that is available. You can just kind of Google that, or probably one of the guys will put up the links for that if you're interested in learning how to play guitar. Little tips and videos can get you so far, but you actually really need a path. You need someone to kind of tell you the path to go down. And so the course seems to do that well. So if you're interested in that, please check that out. We're excited about, a lot of good things happening with live lessons. I was thrilled that we had our first lesson with 5,000 views a few weeks ago. 2 days ago, last week's lesson hit 7,000 views. This morning, it hit 8,000 views. Awesome. And as of this broadcast, we were at 8,900, which is like 1,000 views a day. This is ridiculous, the amount of traffic. So I'm glad you guys are liking the live lessons.
It's great.
I enjoy it. I enjoy helping you guys out. I enjoy bringing fabulous people in to show you how guitar playing is. It's not all about flash and who's the hottest. It's about skills and listening and making guitar parts that fit. And it's not about all this other crazy stuff that we put along with it. It's about being a good craftsman on your instrument. With live lessons, I said I wasn't going to do a live lesson. We had to cancel the one from last week because I was coming back from Cuba. Let me give you just a quick Cuba update. I was down there for a week working with a missionary organization down there, training musicians and music teachers that teach in music schools. And it was absolutely fabulous. Music is alive and well in Cuba. Phenomenal musicians. And are just making it happen. And so it's great. I'll put some more stuff on the discussion board about it. I've got pictures and all kinds of fun stuff of all the wonderful people I met there. But it was a very, very good trip, very, very fruitful trip. So because I had to cancel the one from last week, we are going to have a lesson next week, November 15th. We're going to talk about the Nashville number system. Many of you all have questions about that, so we're going to talk about that next week. And oddly enough, it is the one-year anniversary of live lessons. We've been doing live lessons for 1 year now, and it just is going and going. And so we'll celebrate or have our one-year anniversary next time. And on December 13th, I'm very excited that we're going to have a Christmas edition of live lessons with Phil Kagi.
Awesome.
Who I know.
I just played with him last week. He's great. one of a kind.
One of a kind. One of a kind. I'm so honored that all of these wonderful people are able to pour into you through this venue. If you like our live lessons, if you like what we're doing, look down on your Ustream screen there, and there's a like button if you want to like us for Facebook, or if you're Twitter and you're tweeting and all that sort of stuff. There's a way to do. There's a link down there for that as well. So do that. That helps Ustream to like what we do, and that helps us in all kinds of things. So that's enough of all that nonsense. Let's play a little blues or something as we're heading out. We need to get you on the road. So,
all right, man.
Thank you so much, Will.
It's my good pleasure, Steve.
What an honor to have you here. Thank you for being.
Hope you all enjoyed.
Thank you for being a part of this. Let's just do something in E.
Okay.
A little kind of a quick blues in E. Good night, everyone. We'll see you next time.